Thank you. I wanted to say something at the beginning of my speech, but somebody stole away that word. In artificial intelligence, what is so artificial about it? And I'm so happy that somebody has thought in the line of direction in which I also thought. So I'll take you about 8 years back from today, 2011, when I filed one patent, me being the principal inventor of a software which can convert any financial statements and reports from, say, US GAAP to IFRS, IFRS to Indian GAAP, Indian GAAP to IFRS, and then link it with Oracle's Hyperion consolidation software and front-end link with SAP. I was told by the chairperson of that group, it's an MNC of 247 companies in 20 countries, he said, Paritosh, are you going to run it in my company? I said, yes, it will be. So we ran it for 4 years. So he asked me one question: how do you test the efficacy of your software with the people's effort content? So, you know, by practice and by training and by education, I'm not a software guy. I'm a typical Munimji, I'm an accountant. I'm a chartered accountant and a cost accountant and a PhD in transfer pricing. And of course, I did my DMAC in management accountancy. So I said, sir, you might have thought or you might have implanted through Reiki in my system. I have already built, there are 32 models in my engine, and one of the models which will be supervising the 32 models is the time spent by any user of my engine for those 32 models. He said, what are you going to get about it? I said, the software itself will tell me that how much time a user is spending in a model and how many entries he is making. So in the process, I'm going to know what is the level of difficulty a person is facing and how much more automation I have to do into the system. Do you think anything artificial about it? Who did tell the machine to tell all this information? It's me, no? So the person who said that, what is so artificial about it, I completely agree with you. Now, I am by nature a person who did his PhD 20 years after doing CA. So, and I started teaching in Calcutta University as a visiting faculty in 1989. So I have a nature of researching. So what I'm going to present to you, I'm going to spend at least 20 minutes time. I'm going to present to you something which is absolutely research-based, and Madhu is on my shoulder. He is giving me, instead of 30 minutes, he has given me now 15 minutes time. So I'm going to avoid narratives, and I'm going to talk only on the words, the artificial intelligence and these dimensions of humanity and ethics. Madhu, I can end up spending a little more. Being a conference chair, I can have 5 minutes more with you. Okay, so quickly, let me tell you, all my inputs are research-based, so I owe them to all these researchers. This is an ascension analysis. Ascension analysis is how the world is going to look like by 2030. We are going to add $1 more billion people to our population. It will be $8.5 billion. Two-thirds of the world population will be living in urbans. Maybe villages will be converted to urbans, because urban areas cannot be converted to villages. There will be huge amount of transparency and focus in the world, and world will be less private. The Paris temperature increasing to 40 is going to give us a lesson, and has already given, that the weather will not condone even the poorest of the poor and the richest of the rich nations. Resource pressure will be huge. Clean tech will be required. As you may be knowing, an agriculture, vertical farming is coming up. That means the walls of your building, instead of showing colors, will now start showing vegetables growing there, which is called vertical farming. Technology shift will take in a very big way, and it will be it will be connected to 25 IoTs. By 2025, Deloitte University has said, a common man will be connected to 25 IoTs. And I am pretty problematic about it because IoT has to be on a blockchain platform. So the global policy will be definitely protectionism, and globalization will come quickly down. And finally, there will be radicalism and nationalism both. So this is what is the nine ascension analysis of 2030. You are seeing that first 7 points are star marked. It does mean that I have done, I'm basically a guy who has done research in blockchain, and I have found solution for the first 7 items on blockchain, and it's eighth and the ninth item I'm still working on whether blockchain can give a solution on it. Now the big question coming to AI platform is whether AI and RPA can find a solution for all these 9 problems the world is going to face. Okay, so I'm talking about the human dimensions, and I need not introduce these 3 persons to you anymore because they are the people who are working for the upliftment of the poor in the world. And they have talked about that knowledge is the most important thing for lifting people. So when you say that we will survive in the world of AI and IoT and RPA by the help of our solution providers and ourselves, the answer is yes, together we shall achieve. Here is a gentleman who is a professor of computational neurobiology. His name is Terence. Terence says that, and I read, the future won't be made by either humans or machine alone, but by both working together. Technologies modeled on how human brains work are already augmenting people's ability and will only get more influential as society gets used to increasingly capable machine. Society will get used to capable machine, but the question is, will it be only for HNIs and corporate houses, or will it be for the people on the street, people on the field? Internet has become a darling of the mass only because it is touching people on the field. So AI has to touch the people on the street and who are working on the field, not in the houses where air conditions are there. As you know, there are 3 stages of artificial intelligence. One is ANI, which is narrow. One is AGI, which is general. And one is ASI. There is more onto this. My simple question is, and IBM professionals are sitting here, my simple question is whether we will reach ASI. This question comes this way. With the help of IoT, AI, and artificial intelligence-oriented robots, our senior people at home, staying alone, and they're leading a comfortable life, particularly in the world outside. My question is, will artificial intelligence be able to mimic the wisdom of the senior people? Will they be able to mimic the emotional intelligence of the senior people? That's the most important question, and that's the most ethical part of it. Again, I'll go to one more quote. This lady, again, is a professor. She's the executive director to Global Digital Policy Incubator, Stanford University. And she is also the member of the United Nations Human Rights Council as an ambassador of the US. She says, and very importantly, while I do believe human machines collaboration will bring many benefits to society over time, I fear that we will not have made enough progress by 2030 to ensure that benefits will be spread evenly or to protect against downside risks, especially as they relate to bias, discrimination, and loss of accountability. Since morning, I was keenly watching the talks going on. I have heard the word bias. To a certain extent, I've heard the word accountability, but I have not heard the word discrimination as yet. So let me remind you, if you have to be ethically correct, if you have to be human, you have to avoid discrimination in your AI. So the 3 more important points when you implement, and the MSME friend of mine who was talking about is bias, discrimination, and loss of accountability. These are the 3 words, are very key 3 words for AI implementation. Again, I go to a search. This is one of the top 100 national universities of US called Elon University. Elon University have asked three fundamental questions to 979 CXOs. The first question is, will AI enhance human capacities and empower? Will the life of people be improved? And the last question, very interesting, will it lessen human autonomy and agency? The answer which came, 63% respondents said that yes, it will. Mostly will be benefited by most. And then say 37% said that people will not be better off. So this 37%, the good words can wait. The bad words and the bad information has to be first taken into consideration by digital scientists. And 979 is not a small number. So the analyst, in response to this, the analyst said three things, very important. People will be more and more dependent on networked AI, like you are mentioning from Kotak Bank, I am your customer, and I am your privileged customer. Okay, continue the historic arc of augmenting lives, the mostly positive results. What you are going to do, since I'm going to improve my lifestyle, you are going to bring me into your AI system, and Kia will talk to me, but ultimately what I will become? Will I become a person who is a slave of AI? That's a very important question. The question is, will I be put into difficulties or will my life be easy? That's a big question. So, skepticism exists. How do you take care of the skepticisms? That is the job of ethical and human part of AI. Okay. Now, my another very important research is again from OECD. I'm sure you must be aware of GDPR, but how many of you are aware of these OECD guidelines, which 36 nations under OECD has signed up? The guideline says your AI should foster innovation. And I use the word not innovation, I use the word invention. Innovative invention. That's why I invented that engine, which has been cleared by WIPO, Switzerland, for novelty of invention and mass use. Second is, it should be trustworthy. So AI and blockchain, can it be simultaneously functioning with the help of IoT? That's the question I'm researching on now. It should respect human rights and democratic values. It should go for inclusive growth and inclusive happiness. This is what I talked in my Moscow talk on blockchain. Human-centered values, human-centered fairness, transparency and explainability, robustness and security. I'm requesting all of you sitting in this room as your conference chairperson, please taste your programs, soak it in these five questions and see whether you are coming out colorless. If you are coming with some color, please re-soak it. Still such time you are transparent. This is a very interesting slide, and it's a research slide, again by none other than Oxford, an international development research center. Very interesting point. And I'm amazed to see this research result as late as 2019. $15 trillion, I repeat, $15 trillion will be the value add by AI by 2030. But the important part, which I was talking to Madam Dipali in the lunchtime, is that southern part of equator will be not be benefited out of this $15 trillion. The benefit will come to the upper part of the equator. That is the northern portion, global north, will be better placed. The issue comes up to my mind that will there be discrimination of wealth created by AI? And if this discrimination takes place, will there be another group of people created in this world, which is in the first northern part of the world and the southern part of the world? This is my first question. The second question comes in my mind, whatever $15 trillion will generate, will that be distributed amongst people? Today you are lending with your net interest margin, right? The money which you are saving, are you going to consider your cost of service delivery and increase the rate of interest? And by that process, you will be distributing the wealth you are creating through AI? That's a big question. If you don't do that, then AI is going to benefit only the equity investor, only the promoters of industry, and not the people in the street who, after days old work, can use the internet and order for some food, may not be feeling like cooking. So distribution of wealth is a very important factor. How much of the ROI you will be passing on to your customer as an important point to you to ponder upon. Now I'm going to cling on to my slide. And that's the heart of my slide. I have 9 minutes left. I'll not take more than 9 minutes. What is the ethics of AI? Ethics of AI works on three: quality of prediction, quality of outcomes drawn out of it, and the quality of impact of the outcome and the prediction. It can harm, it may harm, it may not harm. That's up to you and up to you to use the technology. But the important part of it is this particular slide. I'm sure you must soak again your solution in this slide. First point is, what is AI? AI is database models and predictions. But what happens? Is it bias? Is it fair? Is it accountable? Does it give me remedy? Is it transparent? Is it interpretable? And is it explainable? If all these tests are not passed by your AI solution, better rework on your lab. What are the impacts? Automation, jobless labor trends, impact to democracy and civil rights, human-human interaction. What is AI can be? It can be a threat. It can be singularity. It can be robots. My question here is that even if I create a robot tomorrow by AI, I have to also respect that robot. And the robot in turn has the requirement of respecting me. So robotics and RPA has to be developed on the foundation of mutual respect for humanity and a reverse respect for the robot. So artificially intelligent humanoids, one of them has already been given the citizenship of Saudi Arabia. As you know, Sophia has already been granted citizenship of Saudi Arabia. One has to also accept that whatever I do, it has to stand the test of humanity. It has to stand the test of emotional intelligence. As of now, I'm doing a research with two Macquarie University professors of Australia on skepticism of professional auditors. I've gone 1500 BC. 1500 BC, that means 2019 plus 1500 you add, that much year I've gone back to Indian mythology. And to my utter surprise, I have found that the value systems of India are so much strong that you to learn that or relearn that or to know about it and soak it with this is not difficult. Just about 2 hours you need to be convinced that any solution which you develop has to be soaked into this. So another McKinsey study, very interesting study, it says that 78% of jobs can be automated. And it says 25% of the job cannot be automated. One of them is forestry. I'm talking about the negative part, forestry and animal husbandry. And you can see it adds to 103. 3% is the gray area. May or may not be, or can be further. My question is, and my question to all of you, that you have to decide how much of this you are going to do in India, in the context of Indian democratic dividend or demographic dividend, how much AI I should do. But let me tell you one thing. Indians can think. India has a tradition of thinking. At least my 3,500 years of research in India has proved that it is a thinking ability. Shruti and Sriti, these two has given India enormous power. So let's use that, okay? So with this, let me come to my last slide. And this is a slide of 13. I call it 13 principles of AI to be tested, which are important from the context of human ethics and humanity. The first question is directionless. Is AI directionless? I showed you OECD, multinational agency, has already come out with the ethical part. The second question is legal authority. If a humanoid or Kia is advising me and I am working on its advice, and then tomorrow if I end up making loss, is Kotak Bank to be sued or Kia to be sued or the guy who created the software, he is to be sued, or the all 10 tech team members have to be sued? Lawyers have put these questions. I lead a program called MBA Law, first of its kind in India and second in the world. I'm a chairperson of that program. Nobody could answer me that till that today. So if some Kia or some humanoid tomorrow gives you a wrong advice, we have to find the legal position of the robot. Next is unemployment. I'm not on the other side of AI, that AI will throw people out of employment. I'm on the positive side. How much AI will create employment, at least for India? Next question is collaboration. I am very happy to see that some of the robots in the manufacturing parts of the world has collaborated with people. My question is, how much collaboration will take place between RPA and AI? That's important. Next is transition. I heard this panel talking about change management, but my point is painless change management. That's very important. And you know, cultural revolution has to be bloodless, but how much bloodless? Here, the bloodless is replaced by the word jobless, loss of job. Next is inequality, and that's the point I'm harming time and time and time again, that you cannot be benefited by AI. It has to be shared for inclusive growth and inclusive smile. Next is humanity. You cannot make human beings slave of AI. There is a theory called agency theory and stewardship theory in management. In the context of AI and robotics, let me bring that concept. Agency theory is, you are hired by me, you are directed by me, whether you generate result or not generate result, you are not responsible. And stewardship theory is, you offer your services to me, I accept, I engage you, and it is your responsibility to give the benefit. My question is AI going to play the role of an agent, or AI going to play the role of a steward? Like, we are all stewards coming out of our respective business schools. We offer ourselves for value creation. So this stewardship theory is big question. Next is bias of robots. Artificially intelligent robots can be biased. Have you tested your Kia from the biasness testing? Have you? Have you not? That's the point. Next is security. How do I keep AI safe from adversaries of cyber criminals? There is a concept called GAN, General Advisory Network. Whether you have applied GAN for that, and GDPR, whether AI-created information and conclusions you will be handing over to the next service provider as per the GDPR's right to forget rule. So that's a very important issue which you have to take about. Next is evil genius. Everybody doesn't have Aladdin's Pradeep, right? Aladdin's lamp everybody doesn't have. So some of the genies can perform evil, and AI also can perform. So the question is, how do you protect against unintended consequences generated by AI? Yes, I'm through. Just 1 minute is there, and I'm finishing in 1 minute. Last is singularity. How do we stay in control of AI and RPA? Is it that I am going to be controlled? Or is it that I will go and control? That's why the first question comes, what is so artificial about it? Because AI is my Manush Putra, my Manush Kanna. I have given birth to AI from my brain, from my heart, from my mind. So if AI is my Manush Putra, then AI has to function under my control. Robot rights, I talked about it. Robots also have got certain rights. So please respect the rights of robots and RPA. And finally, artificial stupidity. If there is intelligence, there will be stupidity. If it is applicable to a human being, it will be applicable to AI and RPA also, isn't it? How do I take care of the stupidity? How do I take care of the issue that those will not make harm to me? Thank you so much for your patient listening. If any question is there, I'm there for 2 days, and also from this desk I can.